Hi, good morning, everyone. So it's my brief to speak on South Asia. But I will not speak just about the geography of South Asia, but I will also speak about the social formations. Therefore, I'll have to go a little bit into history. And I'll also speak a little bit to education in South Asia, because this is a conference on education in South Asia. So let me first begin with what is this term, South Asia? And where does it originate from? South Asia actually is a neologism. It comes to us from American academia, specifically the area of regional studies. American regional studies, as the US acquired power, started defining regions of the world. And among the regions, they were unable to quite define where the Indian subcontinent was. And the reason also was that they needed a politically neutral term. Because if you call it the Indian subcontinent, or, you know, India, the names by which it was historically known, this name corresponds to a modern nation state after 1947. And this state has a heavy presence in this region. Basically, it actually outnumbers and outweighs all the other states combined. And therefore, there would have been a problem in referring to this as the Indian subcontinent or India, the names by which it was historically known. So they chose a politically neutral term, South Asia, and American academia adopted it, centers were opened, and that is why this term does not have resonance actually in South Asia. If you ask a South Asian in South Asia, that is in India or Pakistan, what is South Asia, they often confuse it with Southeast Asia, even if they're educated. And if they're uneducated, then it's even more difficult. So unlike the terms, say, India, and now Pakistan or Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, it does not have an emotional resonance. It doesn't even have a epistemological resonance among the masses. So I want to therefore start a little bit in history. The historical name for this region was Hindustan sometimes. Sometimes Hindustan was used only for North India. Sometimes Hindustan was used for the whole thing. So what are the origins of this term? Actually, this term comes from the term Sindhu, which means water body, or even sea or river in Sanskrit. But because there was a very big river around which Indian civilization in its earlier phases grew, that is both the Indus Valley civilization and then the Vedic civilization, both on the banks of this river, this region to the east of this came to be called as Sindhu. But the problem was that in Persian, which is also an Indo-European language, the sound sir in Old Persian morphed into the sound her. They sort of replaced this sound in Old Persian. And they started referring to India as Hindu, which was not a religious term at all. It did not refer to a religion at all, specifically, because, for example, within the Vedas or any of the classical Hindu texts, you don't find the word Hindu, because the word Hindu is a Persian word, the word Hindi. From this word, the Greeks dropped the H and adopted Indus. And the Arabs, when they came, they went back to the Persian word, and it again went back to Hind and Hindu. So it had a geographic connotation. Obviously, the complex of religions in this area, therefore, the inhabitants started being referred to by the same name. But if we look at the map of South Asia, Unfortunately, we don't have a physical map, but if we had a physical map, that is, maybe somebody can help me on one side, maybe one projector can have the physical map if gentleman comes back. South Asia can actually be divided into three geographic zones, roughly speaking. There is a mountain wall in the north. This mountain wall separates South Asia from the rest of Asia. It also creates the kind of climatic zones that we see in South Asia. This Himalayan wall, which consists of Nepal, consists of Bhutan, northern parts of India, Afghanistan, etc., is one section. The second section is the Indo-Gangetic Plain, the plain of the Indus and the Ganges. It's a wide area, starting from Pakistan, across India, and into Bangladesh. This forms the second zone within which you find South Asia. And the third is the Deccan Plateau, you know, the peninsula of India, and the coastal areas around it. So in within this, you would have, you know, Sri Lanka. You could even say an extension of it could be Maldives. You could say even parts of Bangladesh and Myanmar reflect that kind of a climatic zone. So we have these three parts. Now, it has been disputed as to up to what point does South Asia extend, but that is not unusual. It is disputed as to what parts are in part in Europe as well, or East Asia, or Southeast Asia. All of these regions are rough approximations. So Afghanistan is counted in South Asia as well as Central Asia, for example. Myanmar is counted both in South Asia and Southeast Asia by people, these being the two border regions. The rest are pretty standard, you know. Mauritius is usually not counted as part of South Asia. That's the only country among the ones present here. But because of its diaspora, because of its population, it is very much, I would say, a South Asian country because of the population there. So that gives you a brief geographic outlay. I'll come back to a little bit more on this, on why we are called a subcontinent. I believe that it's not just because we are cut off from the rest of Asia by this mountain wall in the north, but there are many other reasons, and primarily the range of climatic zones. You know, you have alpine zones, you have dry desert zones, you have river valleys, you have coastal tropical zones, you have subtropical zones. You have a wide variety of people, you know, ethnically, religiously, and different development trajectories, different, therefore, educational trajectories. And I'll come to that. That is a lot, and economists refer to that as part dependency. You know, why Sri Lanka has such a high literacy rate, or Kerala, or why is it so poor in parts of Pakistan and North India? So there's a variety of complex of reasons. But before that, I want to come back to something else that we have in common. I want to explain this with the help of a story. There was a Pakistani writer called Ashfaq Ahmed. Ashfaq Ahmed was himself a kind of Sufi man, and he wrote a story around right after partition called Gadariya. Gadariya means the shepherd in Urdu and Hindi. This is the story of a Muslim boy called Golu and his teacher, who's a Khatri, Hindu Khatri. His name is Chintaram, but he's referred to by the boy and everybody in the story as Dauji. The story is set in Punjab in the 1930s or 40s. And this story, for me, encompasses what South Asia was, what changes it underwent, and what the outcome was. And it has a very important moral and about education itself. What is education? What was education? What is education? So Golu has a very bad habit. He's very fond of reading fantasy, medieval fantasy books, specifically, you know, Tilisma Hoshruba and the Arabian Nights, and he doesn't study. Even in class, he has these books which are under his textbooks, and he keeps going through them. Finally, he manages through bribery to go from 9th to 10th, but the 10th is a board exam conducted by Punjab University, and he's unable to bribe them, and he fails. This leads to a big crisis in his life. He and some of his other failed friends decide that they are going to run away to Lahore and open a shop there, but their plan is foiled, and his father hands him over to Dauji. Dauji is basically a Hindu Khatri who was a shepherd, but has now educated himself in, and I'll come to that, what that process was. And he is now taken into Dauji's house. He goes in the day to the school, and from afternoon onwards, he's at Dauji's house where he receives tuition and from him personally. He sleeps in his house. And the education is what was typical in those days in the 30s and 40s in the Punjab. Basically, you would have geography, you would have Farsi, you would have history, Mughal history as well as British colonial history. You would have mathematics. And the story is full of these struggles of being woken up in the middle of the night to be asked questions, woken up early in the morning. It's an endearing story of a relationship between a teacher and a student. But in the middle, there is a kind of flashback. And Dauji explains how he became literate in the first place, which is a fascinating story in itself. This is a semi-biographical story. He explains that he was a shepherd, and one day when he was taking his sheep out, there was a Muslim saint who was, paralyzed from the waist below, who used to sit with boys and teach them in the village. And this saint has, a Sufi has some kind feelings towards him and invites this boy to come and sit and take classes. And it goes back in a way to a tradition which is long there in South Asia. You can see it in the Gurukuls, you can see it in the madrasas, you can see it in the, you know, where there is a guru and a shishya, the Sufi master, the peer or the murshid, and the murid, the student. And he begins to teach him. He teaches him, first of all, literacy in Urdu and Persian. He teaches him maths. He teaches him, and this boy acquires a knowledge which cannot, it's difficult to say whether this was a Islamic knowledge, Islamic system of epistemology, or it was Hindu, or it was something else, because he acquires such a deep knowledge of the Quran in the process, and such a deep knowledge of Persianate literature, because, you know, there is this whole tradition. South Asia is more influenced by Persia than it is by, South Asian Islam is more influenced by Persian than by Arabic. And this is not unusual, because actually, if you look at the life of one of the most famous and influential proto-nationalists, Raja Ram Mohan Roy, he himself was a scholar of Arabic and Persian, because he early in his life had been sent to a Persianate school because his family came from a tradition of Mughal scribes. And he, of course, knew Sanskrit as well. And finally, he learned English and became one of India's first social reformers and religious reformers. So this man acquires knowledge and serves his master. But at one point, when he's doing a problem on isosceles triangles, he gets stuck. And he goes to his master, and his master says, I cannot solve this problem also. And he says that when a student reaches the level of his master and the master can't solve his problems, then it's time for the student to find a new master. And he tells him that there's a master in Delhi who is a great master of mathematics. You must go and meet him. And he'll be able to take your education forward. But you must take permission from your mother. The boy goes and he's unable to get the permission from the mother. And so frustrated, he runs away after a while. It shows you what South Asia was. The boy doesn't have enough money to reach Delhi. So he works on the railway line between Delhi and Western Punjab every day. He works one day, earns money, and walks for 2 days. And then works one day, and then walks for 2 days, reaches Delhi, cannot find this man's house because he doesn't have an address, because he never took permission from his old master. He just ran away. So he goes in Delhi, and at that point, the city of Delhi is being made. So he works on these British housing projects and then tries to search for him, sleeps in the dharamshala, local dharamshala. Finally, he manages after a while to locate this teacher. And when he lands at his place, the teacher is constantly looking down. He can't understand. And he says, I have come looking for you. I have come from so-and-so place. And the teacher knew. He says, you are Chintaram. He says, yes, I am Chintaram. And he says, you have come from so-and-so place. I already know your master has sent me a letter. So come, let me solve your problem. And he says, he takes off his shirt and he says, draw the triangles on my back. The boy is stunned, you know, this very odd. There are other people in the room and he's stunned. He doesn't know what to do. So he starts, then the old man explains that I am actually blind. I can't see. So the only way I will know these triangles are if you draw on my back. And he draws the triangles on his back, explains the problem, and the master tells him, you know, drop the perpendicular. And he drops the perpendicular, and then he solves the problem for him. And then this boy stays with this master for 1 year, basically coming and learning from him for another 1 year, and then goes back to his hometown. This shows you his thirst for knowledge. And I want to just read out a similar letter, a similar emotion which was expressed in a letter to Copernicus. Copernicus was written a letter by Cardinal Nicholas von Schönberg, Archbishop of Capua. Yet, Copernicus is not famous yet. He has written his theory, but he's not publicized it yet because he's afraid of the church. So he says, this cardinal says, some years ago, word reached me concerning your proficiency, he's writing to Copernicus, of which everybody constantly spoke. At that time, I began to have a very high regard for you, for I had learned that you had not merely mastered the discoveries of the ancient astronomers uncommonly well, but had also formulated a new cosmology. In it, you maintain that the earth moves, that the sun occupies the lowest and thus the central place in the universe. Therefore, with the utmost earnestness, I entreat you, most learned sir, unless I inconvenience you, to communicate this discovery of yours to scholars, and at the earliest possible moment to send me your writings on the sphere of the universe together with the tables and whatever else you have that is relevant to this subject. I will, of my own expenditure, copy all of this and send you a reimbursement. So this is a fascinating letter written to Copernicus, showing the thirst yet, and a similar thirst was present in India. So what happened? Why did we not produce our own Copernicus in the 16th or 17th or 18th century? Why did Daoji go back? I mean, there are many reasons for this, and we can do that in the Q&A. It refers to both the fact that the church provided a religious institution with a learning capacity, you know, an associated system of universities. It refers also to the fact that Europe needed those mathematical and physical advancements because of the discovery of the New World and the discovery of Africa, the physical challenges involved. That is, the needs of empire, the needs of secular enterprise required those kinds of knowledge. It was similar to why knowledge prospered in the Middle East during the Islamic empires. They needed that knowledge for their day-to-day governance. But also, of course, it is also associated with religious institutions, and we'll look at that. But Daoji goes back. And things remain fine. He becomes a scribe in the courts of law. And he teaches these children. This boy finally passes his exam and goes off to university and forgets about his master. He writes to him, but the letters become less frequent. And as happens in life, he has kind of moved on. But then the partition of India happens. It's 47, and he has come back to his house to escape the violence in Lahore. And this time, his mother says, go and see what is happening to Daoji and his wife. So he goes to the house. Meanwhile, Daoji's own son has gone off to Lahore and is also practicing with the RSS at that point. And Daoji disapproves of it, but his son does that. When this boy reaches Daoji's house, the house is empty and he's worried. Maybe Daoji has been killed, or maybe he has run away, you know, to India or across the border. Then he notices that there is a big crowd around an old man. This crowd consists mostly of refugees. This was the nature of partition violence. Partition violence was an iterative process. When violence happens and refugees go across the border, they create new violence in the new place. Of course, the locals also join in, but it happens because of the refugees coming in. The refugees bring their stories of what happened to them, and the refugees also need a place to live. So they need to kick out whoever is there. This crowd is around Daoji, and Daoji himself is a kind of Sufi saint himself. You know, he knows the Persian Sufi literature so well, and Arabic as well. So they start saying, should we kill him? The crowd is asking, you know, what should we do with him? And finally one man says, let me see if he can recite the kalama, the profession of faith in Islam, you know. And so the man catches hold of his collar and says, old man, can you recite the kalama? And Daoji asks him, which kalama? Because there are at least 6 or 7 kalamas. He says, which kalama do you want me to recite? And he says, shahadat. So he recites it. And at the moment he recites it, these other men say, no need to kill him. We will use him as our shepherd. We have a lot of sheep here. And that's where the story ends. So how did we reach this point? How did this story actually in itself encompasses what happened to South Asia over the last 300, 200 years? What happened? There was a culture. We know from the early accounts of South Asia. There are accounts even before this, like by the Chinese travelers, Hyun Sang, Fayan, you know, about what kind of education was provided in the universities in Nalanda and Takshala. But the first person account detail that we have is from Al-Biruni, around 1,000 years ago. And he covers a wide range. He covers the range of mathematics in India. He covers what was happening in India in astronomy, and also religion, astrology as well, and in medicine. In a lot of areas, he gives a detailed account. It's one of the finest accounts you will find of India and its civilization at that point. Al-Biruni's account is special because Al-Biruni is widely now considered by historians to be the greatest intellect between the ancient world and the Renaissance. There is no mind like his, and in terms of this range, because he's very deep into trigonometry and spherical trigonometry. He's a great geographer. He creates maps. He's a man of many talents, like Leonardo da Vinci. So Al-Biruni gives us an account where actually the Brahmins are very, very conservative. They're very suspicious. They don't want to share their knowledge, even with their fellow countrymen, he says. And he has to convince them. He himself has to learn Sanskrit over many years. He stays many, many years in India, and then he can get information from them. But he is also deeply admiring of what they have already arrived at. But he says the problem is they have now become closed to outside knowledge. And so there's a whole process. The reason I'm mentioning this is that this, you can see the difference between this period and already by the 17th, 18th century, things have changed. You know, there are many Hindus who are now, because of the Mughal state and others, conversant with the knowledge of the Middle East. There are many Muslims who are deeply into Hindu knowledge systems, including bhakti. I mean, some of the greatest, it's now we don't speak of it in India because of our the way we are looking at history today, since the last 50 or 100 years. But some of the greatest bhakti poets were actually Muslims. Ras Khan, you know, and Abdul Rahim Khan Khana, and all of these people. So we had worked out in South Asia a modus vivendi. That is a way of living with each other over a thousand years. What happened then? Why was it split? Why the shattering that we see today? Across South Asia, we see this problem. One of the fundamental ways in which our society is today divided is along the lines of religion. The way we make parliamentary majorities across in each country is on the basis of religion. Religion has come to have an outsized impact on both our daily lives, on our political lives. It has been magnified to the eclipsing of many other aspects of our lives. So what happened? How did this happen? Why did the nation state lead to this? Why did electoral politics lead to this? And what has happened? Why has our history become so contested? It's a highly contested, it's the most contested actually area of pedagogy and of knowledge production in South Asia today. What were these changes? So to get an idea of what happened in South Asia, actually, it would be, I know, you know, people would say, why look outside? But we have to look at the history of Europe, and we have to look at the history of East Asia and in North America as well. Benedict Anderson gives us a very good account of what happens with the arrival of literacy. What happened in Europe? What happened? What is modernity, and what is the project of modernity? In the medieval world, in Europe as well as in India, only 1% of the population could read or write. Sometimes not even that, but sometimes 1%. If it was an urban area, then maybe 2%, but no more. In the rural areas, it would be 1 or less. So what happens? He talks about print capitalism, Benedict Anderson. He talks about the arrival of the printing press, about how it creates identity, and how the modern state then creates identity. The state has its own project in order to create coherence. Print capitalism has its own reason in order to sell enough that it has to create single language communities. And how this literacy project also leads to religious revivalism, to arrive at the origins of your imagined religion, to arrive at the origins of what is the true religion, what is the truth of our past. It led to the wars of religion in Europe for 100 years. the Hundred Years' War, you know, between Catholicism and various forms of Protestantism. One third of Central Europe was depopulated. And from its ashes arose these modern nation states. You know, these ideas also, with the arrival of literacy, became popular. Ideas of popular sovereignty, that is, legitimacy resides in the people's will, and therefore elections are the only way of determining who's right and who can govern and who can make laws. The state itself, which was earlier an imperial or a kingdom, was transformed into a nation state. That is, there are these independent nations which have existed from an immemorial past, which have now come alive, and each one deserves its own state. And these nations are the owners of that state. These nations own that piece of land. Others are foreigners in this piece of land. Others who constitute a minority are foreigners in this piece of land. These are the only true legitimate inheritors. This process happened again in East Asia. It happened again in the West. I mean, a second wave of nationalism happened, which led to huge amount of conflict in the 20th century. We are all aware of it, the First, Second World War. Finally, they had to arrive again at a modus vivendi. They had to arrive at a way of being at peace with each other. The same problem arose in East Asia, first with Japan and China, and then with the rest of Southeast Asia. The same problems arose in a limited way in North and South America, in the Western Hemisphere. And the same problem has arisen in India. In India, the peculiar problem, not just in India, but by India, I mean the South Asia, by Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Ceylon, the old name for Sri Lanka. The problem was the census, the way the British counted. The British, in their own country, never counted Catholics and Protestants as separate. The census had been operating in England for 100 years before the census was brought to India. Catholics and Protestants were never counted as separate. But the same problem can also be seen in Myanmar. They start defining who is Hindu, they start defining who is Muslim, who is Christian, they start counting, they start enumerating. And then everything is divided on that basis. Political representation is on that basis, representation in educational institutions is on that basis, representation in jobs is on that basis. And this deepens that sense of identity along those lines. These lines were not that hard. These lines were deepened by modernity. And the way we constructed that modernity. The same problem in Sri Lanka. There was no intrinsic problem between Tamils and Sinhala. But the census, once it started counting Burghers and Sinhala and these people as separate, the same problem in Myanmar. Once you define Rohingyas as foreigners in the 30s, and you describe native tribes, same problem in India. Muslims were described as foreigners, even though almost all the Muslims in India are local converts, and Islam has been in India for 1,000 years. They were therefore now guests. And there were some people who were the majority who were claimants to it. And the same problem arose in Pakistan after independence, because there was a different owner of that piece of land, and similarly in Bangladesh. So the arrival of modernity was catastrophic for South Asia. It was catastrophic for the minority specifically, but also for the majority, because the majority lost its own way of life. And a new way of life was being constructed on the basis of this newly arrived literacy. Reform movement started, Arya Samaj, Dayanand Saraswati. They wanted to go back to the past, you know, a golden Vedic age. Muslims wanted to go back to the caliphate. Because now it was not just ulema who could read or pandits who could read, but everybody can read. And when you can read, you want to go back to the original text. You want to go to the origins. Because this modus vivendi that we have developed over thousands of years seems fake. It seems something that we have constructed artificially. We want to go back to some place where there was only one kind of people, only one kind of religion, only one kind of way of life. Literacy again led also to the problems with caste. I'm not saying it created, but it accentuated those problems Why? Because then what happened is all India caste communities began to emerge. Why? Because now there was printing press, there was newspapers, there was railways with which to communicate with each other. And so you could deepen that identity and you could ask for jobs on the basis of that identity, educational representation on the basis of that identity. So that identity was deepened. And so there was no universalist conception of citizen or humanity. It was particularist, you know. And also liberalism, therefore, could not take deep roots. Because liberalism ultimately is an individualist project. It is not a group rights project. So you see this repeatedly, you know, that people are asking, what is your identity? And on the basis of that, they will treat you. The state will treat you on the basis of that. You will treat each other on the basis of that. This would automatically lead to conflicts. And the history of South Asia is now a testament to that. That literacy and modernity have been double-edged swords. They have not been a singular good. Because from this project came the project of history. What kind of history do you construct? History became contested. Because history for the nation state serves the same project, serves the same purpose as myth used to serve in ancient times. History has now become our myth. Why? Because myth, in the words of social scientists, is a social charter. Myth tells us how society should be structured. It justifies the structure of society and the boundaries of society. Now history serves that purpose. History will now define our boundaries and it will define how society is justified, its structure. So the nation state is very, very possessive and protective of the history project. So you would be surprised, this Asia, this South Asia has a very common history, actually, whether it is the Indian Ocean region and its history or the networks of North India and the Silk Route. But each state has its own history and it's very different. The history of Bangladesh is very different from the history now being taught in Indian schools. It is very different from the Pakistani educational system, which is very different from Sri Lanka. Which is very... So, what are they doing? What's going on? These histories are actually not just looking at the past. They are recreating the past. And in order to define a vision for the future, each of these histories is not just defining the past, it's also defining a vision for the future. What kind of a state you want? What kind of a society you want? Across South Asia, this is happening. So, you know, the arrival of modernity, the arrival of literacy also brought knowledge. But it has also brought these social ills. We got the form of the nation state as the political form. We got popular sovereignty, right? But these again are double-edged swords. We think of democracy as an unmitigated good, but that's not true. Across the world you can see that, not just in South Asia. It has specific problems. It is not leading to a government by consensus. It is leading to a government by majority will. And in each of these countries, their minorities are suffering. These minorities can be caste minorities or ethnic minorities or religious minorities, but they're suffering. So we have to figure out ways of mitigating this. There are remedies. It is not impossible. The remedies lie both in the areas of education, they lie in the areas of political structure and social formation. Now, what are we supposed to understand? How did we arrive at this present moment? My contention is that any particular region arrives at a particular place through a certain path dependency. This path dependency depends a lot on your geography, because your geography and your climate and your water resources determine what kind of economic activity takes place there, agricultural activity. Your position on the coast determines what kind of trade takes place there, or your position inland or in the mountains. That determines what kind of a society is thrown up, what kind of a social structure is thrown up. On top of that, you layer that with the kind of political structures or colonial structures that came up, you know, areas where the British arrived first, areas which were, say, densely populated, like the river valleys, or which were sparsely populated, areas which were sparsely populated had more of a tribal structure, areas which were densely populated had a complex social hierarchy and caste, different levels of socioeconomic development. How early the British came determined what level of education was there, what level of higher education was there, what level of primary education was there, what kind of governance and land revenue structure, whether you had a mehelwari system or you had a riotwari or zamindari permanent settlement, that led to differences. Whether it was ruled by a princely state, native state, with only British as agents, or whether it was directly ruled by the British, led to different outcomes in development. It led to different outcomes in education. You can see that in the Travancore state. You can see that in Kerala. You can see that in Sri Lanka. Was policy decided? How was policy decided? Why was, for example, one of the biggest problems which arose was that education became a state subject. In the North India, I can tell you that this was a problem. Why did the Nehruvian state do this? Why? Because it was already there. The British had already done this. In the Government of India Act of 1935, education is already a state subject. There was already a part dependency to that. It was already there in the Morley Minto reforms, 1919. So there was a part dependency. So when you say, why is Travancore achieved, why Kerala has achieved this high rate of literacy, why did everybody else fail, why did Bihar or UP fail, why is Sri Lanka? It is not due to a conscious agency. There is no conscious agency here. It is thousands, at least hundreds of years of history which has led to that. And their geography, their particular demographics, their particular social structure, their particular political structure, their particular history, which has led to that outcome, you know. Why we can't reform some systems despite trying so hard? Why others are more amenable to reform? You know, these are at the heart of the problem in South Asia. To understand these, to be able to come up with solutions for these. So, now, is the story only sad? Is it only a story of loss and tragedy in South Asia? Or is there more to it? You know, how does South Asia compare with other parts of the world? What is the future life of South Asia? You know, I don't think it's a story merely of loss, because we know that there are other parts of the world which are doing even worse, actually. And we know that over time, things might have improved even in South Asia, somewhere more rapidly and somewhere more slowly. But I think we need to also be able to define a future. Whether we are in Pakistan, or we are in India, or we are in Bangladesh, or wherever we may be, we need to be able to clarify to our people what an unbiased history looks like. Because unless you do that, the other person is always the evil one. We are always angels. And this is what our media also feeds back, whether it is our print media or electronic media. This is what it feeds us. This is what our state wants us, right? And the state has its own processes of indoctrination. You know, Benedict Anderson, coming back to him again, those processes are well known. It is, you know, in the judiciary, whether it is in the government offices, the maps that you see, the logos, the maps serving as logos, the flags, the national anthems, the school system, the school curricula. This is the way the state creates, you know, an ontology, literally. It has shaped and carved our minds, you know. So to be able to create an educational system which provides and is slightly independent of the state, I think is very important. This project has been fought many times across the world. For example, in Germany itself, the educational system was part of the church. Maybe that actually was better for Germany. Because once Bismarck took over, the state took over that educational system, it ended up with Hitler finally. You know, that same late 19th century German system finally ended up with Nazism. So maybe an independence from the state is required, you know. Also a way in which we don't overly emphasize university education. This was one of the great flaws of Nehru and the Nehruvian system. But again, this was a legacy from our past. Again, there was some part dependence in this. We just did not focus enough, at least in most of India, on primary education, you know. And this is why we have ended up with this. We cannot explain the modern nation state to a person who does not understand liberalism. For that, you know, liberalism itself, even in the West, comes only when education has received and literacy has achieved a certain percentage. There was no liberalism in 17th century Europe. Jews, not only Jews, Catholics were persecuted in Protestant countries. Protestants were massacred in Catholic countries. There's a whole Saint Bartholomew's Day massacre in France, you know, where the Protestants were just murdered. Hundreds of thousands, lakhs of Protestants were just killed on the streets. So you cannot explain these modern conceptions or hope that people will appreciate these without having spread literacy, without having spread education. And I mean, literacy is also not enough. Literacy is not enough for education. There's much more to education. So the whole emphasis has also led to a lopsided economic structure. India is unique among developing countries. And now Pakistan is coming into the same region. Only Bangladesh has escaped, where manufacturing is not seen as the main path of escaping poverty. We are relying on a services-led model, where a highly educated upper strata of society is going to create jobs in which others are going to be pulled out. And what are these jobs? These are jobs of, you know, a rickshaw puller or a tea maker. We are hoping that it will percolate down. This is not happening. Jobs are not being created because of our educational system. Most of the world's great economists have told India that you cannot reach even middle income without this. Paul Krugman, among others, have informed India that, look, you need manufacturing. But manufacturing you cannot have, because manufacturing requires an educational base. There is a reason why China became manufacturing hub of the world. China became a manufacturing hub because it had already achieved universal health and universal literacy. Even now, as China is becoming high cost, manufacturers are not coming to India. You know where they are going? They're going to Vietnam, another post-communist country. They're going to Bangladesh. Bangladesh is the most amazing story of all of South Asia, actually. Please don't pay attention to the politics these days, because they're not informing you correctly. No Bangladeshis are coming to India anymore. They stopped coming a long while ago, because India is worse than Bangladesh. Bangladesh is booming, precisely because they achieved literacy, they achieved women's participation, their NGOs, whether it was BRAC or Grameen, managed to create a base, and their economic policies allowed manufacturing to take place, textile manufacturing to take place. This is where women are being empowered. Yes, the job might look very tiny to you, pittance it might look to you, you know, what is this woman receiving, you know, $150, $200. This is a lot compared to what she used to receive. With this, she can feed her children, she can educate her children. With the help that BRAC gives, adult literacy can take place, child nourishment can take place. And so Bangladesh is actually creating manufacturing growth. Bangladesh already on many human development indicators is far ahead of India and Pakistan. And if the political situation remains stable, it's a big if, Bangladesh might actually be the most miraculous performer in South Asia. Sri Lanka almost achieved that, but was set back because of decades of violence, ethnic violence. But again, now Sri Lanka is recovering, and hopefully it'll take its rightful position among the middle-income nations of the world. So what I'm saying is that our educational policies have completely thrown into disarray India's development trajectory itself. You cannot achieve the eradication of mass poverty with services-led growth. primarily because a very small percentage of your population has those skills. Secondly, because the rest of the world doesn't want services. China, America, everybody's blocking services trade. So there's not enough potential for growth there. So what educational policies you follow lead to what economic policies lead to what development, it is all path dependent. That we are becoming increasingly self-aware has to now be translated into political action. The problem is, how do you get political action? It's a chicken and egg situation when in the first place your voter itself is not educated. So you end up with the wrong kind of first past the post system, which we again got in part dependency from the British, rather than have what would be a more productive system, as in Germany now, that is the proportional representation system. So the complex of factors which South Asia is facing today and faces for the future are formidable. And it is the job of educators like you to figure out pathways. Some great work is being done, I know, in India at TIS and at Azim Premji with teacher education. And we need millions of such teachers across India, especially in the north, because otherwise there are going to be severe problems. The south already is having a very different development trajectory from the north. I fear for the future. Both the population growth rates and the literacy levels are very different in the south from the north. This has very bad portents, prognosis for India over the next 2 or 3 decades as these different paths fructify. So I thank you for listening to me, and I would like to open up for Q&A. Can we get a physical map of South Asia if possible? I'll just, that will be the best way to actually see this. Just physical map of South Asia. That would actually be the best way of, look at it, even this map is illegal actually in India. You can't show this map in India. I can get arrested in my classroom for being showing this map. Because this map shows that part of Kashmir is with Pakistan and China. I cannot show this in my class. When the state is so protective of its narrative that even the map can be a source of criminal procedure, imprisonment. How can you share knowledge? How can you provide an alternate narrative? You can't show the true map of India. This is not the, what map is shown is not the true map of India at all. The students are surprised when the first time I show them the actual territory which is now controlled by the Indian state. Yeah, that's fine. You can already see the first part of South Asia. We can see the mighty Himalayas, Karakoram and the Hindu Kush. And the Suleiman Range and Zagros separate us from the Iranian plateau. On this side also, the highlands of Burma, of Myanmar, separate us from the rest of East Asia. The second is the Indo-Gangetic Plain, the plain of the Indus River and the plain of the Ganges River. The most densely populated parts of South Asia, starting from Bangladesh. This is the most densely populated. Population density then declines as we move to the west and then suddenly increases again along the Indus. In the south, again, population density is low in the center because it's a dry Deccan plateau. And on the edges, in the coastal areas, population density is high because both because of monsoon rains as well as because of the rivers, river systems. So high population along the coastlines. Even in the river systems, there's a difference. This is more densely populated because it receives both rainfall and irrigated from rivers, irrigation from rivers. Here, there's less rainfall, basically dependent on mostly irrigation. So the land yield was less. In Bengal, it used to give 3 harvests. In Bangladesh and Bengal, 3 harvests in a year. That is why it was the richest province for the Mughals. It was also the richest revenue earner for the British. Of course, they destroyed it in the process because they extracted so much from it. The Greeks, even Herodotus was surprised when the Greeks for the first time arrived in South Asia. Herodotus says that India is unique. It has 2 harvests because Europe used to have only 1 harvest in a year. So India is rich.
Thank you very much. I want to go to your point about moving out of a story of loss and tragedy and fragmentation to a story of affirmation. And it seemed that you ended your talk by suggesting that political action constitutes the affirmation forward. But I find that a bit contradictory, because that very political affirmation might actually cement further fragmentation. I wondered if you want to comment on that issue. Where are the levers for affirmation and working towards a more positive future?
There are solutions. It is not a hopeless situation, is what I'm trying to say. The solutions lie both in, you're right, in the non-political, that is in the educational field, in development and social areas. But the political action is very important. We cannot ignore politics. This is my point. You cannot have peace between India and Pakistan just by people's movement. It's been tried for 40 years, nothing has moved. You can't have peace like that. Political action has to happen. I will tell you how there was peace in America. United States and the UK were not friends in the 19th century. They were big enemies. They fought a war, the War of 1812, in which the British occupied the White House and burnt it down. They came from Canada and occupied White House. How did they become friends? There's a book on this by Charles Kupchan, How Enemies Become Friends. And it applies also for India. It applies also for the Soviet Union versus the United States. Basically, what happened was that Germany was rising by the 1870s, 1880s. And the United Kingdom, at that time Great Britain, determined that we cannot maintain naval supremacy. We cannot maintain naval supremacy while dividing our fleet. Because now Germany has become the largest industrial producer in the world, steel producer. We cannot take on the United States and Germany at the same time. We need to make peace. So they came to a deal with the US, which said the Western Hemisphere is yours. We will not interfere in North and South America, but you leave everything else to us in the East. The United States said, okay, you can take care. This way they could take care of Germany. This allowed the people then to start interacting with each other. First the governments made peace, and then the people could start making peace with each other, and industrial trade, political contacts increased. Same thing happened between the Soviet Union and the United States. First, the Soviet Union had to collapse. Which, I mean, in the case of UK, that was not the case. But in the case of Germany, this was the case. Basically, Germany had to lose the Second World War. But we don't want to go down that route. We don't want devastation of that kind. We don't want a First World War and a Second World War. But this is the route we are headed for. Because nation states, when nationalism comes newly to a territory, it comes with a lot of passion. And that passion creates war. We have seen it in East Asia. We have seen it in Europe. We have seen it in North America. We don't want that in South Asia. Nationalism is rising across South Asia. People are burning. It is religious nationalism, or can be even secular nationalism. People are burning. We don't want that outcome. Political action, therefore, is necessary. And also there are ways to remedy the politics. A proportional representation system will give you a very different kind of politics from what a first-past-the-post, winner-takes-all politics gives you. If you look at the governments in most of South Asia, they have been created with just 30-33% of the vote base. Even the leading parties in South Asia have 33-35-35-38. They don't have a majority of the vote anywhere. It is not a truly representative government anywhere in South Asia in terms of representing the will of the people. And this government doesn't need to compromise, because even with 35%, they have a full majority in parliament. So they don't need to compromise. A proportional representation builds in compromise. It builds in a coalition. You can see Germany today. It builds in. They're forced to compromise with different sections of society. And therefore, they have a much... So I say we cannot ignore politics, sir. We certainly could lead to problems through politics, but politics also has to be addressed. It cannot be just social action. It cannot be just education.
Yeah, thank you very much. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I got the sense from the talk, you know, like now it's time for less state engagement with schooling. In a sense, I mean, we can already see that, you know, like in most of the South Asian countries, so the state already is retracting from public education, and that void is being filled by private schools. So, I mean, what is your sense of, you know, like less, for the state to engage less with?
See, my point was not towards that. My point slightly was slightly different. I think the state should stop interfering with pedagogy. It needs to stop interfering with syllabi. We have to push back against the state's interference in syllabus making. The syllabus is what I'm most concerned with. It is society, civil society, which needs to make syllabi. But should the state support and create? There are many views on this. You know, there is the voucher system in which the state contributes, but is a more hands-off approach. It, you know, it, that has been tried in other places. Whether that system will work or not, I'm not an expert on educational system, so I cannot say whether, you know, a voucher system is better than a privately funded or a subsidized or a universal fee, a universal income system. I'm not sure what is the best system to deliver, but you know, we can see that actually the state control of education, at least from where I am, has failed completely in UP and Bihar. And there's a reason for that, because education system and schools are the primary vehicles for politics. What has happened is that you can get a job as a schoolmaster and you don't have to go to school. The money that you get from it is a steady income. Now you can do politics. You can become a member of a political party, do campaigning for them. You don't have to worry about income. All members of political parties need a steady income because politics doesn't pay a steady income. So school jobs have become a way of becoming. So what happens is that all political parties try to fill their own people into the school system, whether they are qualified or not. These people then get elected and becomes member of state legislature. UP state legislature at one point had 33% of its members as former school teachers. So what are you going to do? They're going to block every reform. So I'm not a big fan of the state, to be honest.
I agree with that, even in Sri Lanka. The scenario that I'm very concerned about at the moment, and it has been for all this time also, is that we have state universities predominantly giving higher education. And it's such a shame that academics in state universities also believe that it is their right that children who come to state universities only should be having higher education. So it's been a big struggle for, you know, loners like me to say, no, we need to have other sectors come in as education providers, you know. So in a situation like that, where only 16% of the children sitting the A-level examination gets a placement in state universities, it becomes quite chaotic. And very recently, actually, the day I was flying out, I saw that the Supreme Court ordered children of a private medical college to be given license to practice, which the Sri Lanka Medical Council all this time said, no, you cannot practice. Mm. You know what I mean? Mm. So your comment about political intervention, I truly believe. But when the politicians are also in this mindset, how do you overcome?
That's a great question. We have had the same problem in South Asia. When I started working for a private university, people looked down upon me in the state, my friends in the state educational system, the universities, the government universities, saying that, you know, you have sold out. And I understand where they were coming from. I understand totally where they were coming from. But the problem today is they have no freedom in their curriculum. And now they sometimes ask me for jobs in private universities, where you can still teach your own curriculum without state interference. And because you see, ultimately, when you're a state university, you're as good only as the government of the day wants you to be. The government of the day determines your syllabus. So they won't even allow speakers. The government of the day will not allow speakers which don't agree with the government to speak. And what is a university at the end of the day? It's a space for open thought, free thought. If you look at the origins of the university in the West, the university has arisen in the same way as a corporation. It's very interesting. People who hate private universities should remember this. What do I mean by that? The legal status given to a university in the West was that of personhood. just like a corporation is a person in law. Therefore, it has its own rights which you cannot interfere with. It gets a charter from the king or the queen. It used to get. And it was protected by both ecclesiastical law and by civil law. This allowed a freedom to the university. This person, this is why the West was able to thrive. The university became a space where if Galileo worked in that space, unfortunately he did not. He was working in the Vatican and the church. But for example, Newton. There was no interference in Newton's work. Newton could not have done his work if the state was constantly interfering with the curriculum of Cambridge in those days. He could not have done his work because it was challenging the heliocentric theory was challenging the earth-centric theory of the universe. So you're absolutely right. It is not just the government which is interfering, but also some of our academia who used to look down on private learning, and yet they would all go when called by Harvard and Stanford and Yale, all of which were built with private money. All of these are private institutions. The world's top 10 institutions are all private. And in fact, Yale was built with the money which was taken from Madras. The governor of Chennai, the British governor of Madras, Yale, took his savings and built Yale. So it's partly built with blood money also. But of course today, Yale is supporting the most progressive work across the world with its funding.
So on your last thing, I've started to disagree, I think, with your position now. I think it's quite dangerous to say that the state should withdraw from public education.
I'm not saying it should withdraw. I didn't say that.
You're not a fan of the state. Yes, but you know, if you look at historical examples of cases where literacy rates have gone up and have reached 100%, as far as I know, almost universally these are examples where education has been public. I mean, you know, if you look at the erstwhile socialist bloc, whatever else you might say about them, these were places which were extremely successful in education and as a result of public investment. Now, even these advanced capitalist countries, which are very far from being socialist, have largely public education systems, certainly at the primary level. And, you know, even in many cases at the secondary and tertiary level. So, in fact, I don't know of any example where education is, and maybe you do, so maybe you could give me examples, where education at the primary level is largely in private hands and which has had successful educational outcomes. So I think that's one thing to say. The second thing to say, I think, is this is a more minor comment. This is the comment I made right now about public education is my main point. But you know, I agree. Of course, there's an attack on academic freedom, but I think it would be naive if we were to believe that you know private institutions are less vulnerable to that than public institutions. I mean, for that matter, this is a public institution, and you know we've seen what's happened in Ashoka University very recently, where the vice chancellor has basically been thrown out by the government. And so I think, you know, we would be naive if we were to imagine that. I would say private institutions are very vulnerable, and in fact, in some ways, more so. So, I mean, this is just something. So there's a broader attack on academic freedom that we need to act against, and I think this dichotomy between private and public is a little bit of a facile thing.
Yeah. So, yeah. Okay. So, you're absolutely right that private universities too will break under pressure because the state has just too much power in South Asia. Specifically in India, I can say that the state just has too much power. But I totally disagree with your view of public universities. Public universities are very poor performers in India, actually. If you see the total research output of most public universities, even the most famous, I don't want to take names, it's really poor. And if you see the research output of Ashoka alone in the last 5 years, I'm not a member of Ashoka or have nothing to do with Ashoka. It will exceed that of most public universities of the same size with the same number of faculty and the same departments. So I think yes, you're right. I mean, ultimately, it's a deeper problem. It's not a public-private problem. It's a problem of how much power the state has, and that has to be whittled down. And that's what liberalism is about, you know. You have to curb state power. And I believe that India is a living example of the failures of public education, actually. If you look at the ACER outcomes. And if you look at even those who have gone to a public school, government school, and their learning outcomes at each level from third grade onwards, second, third grade onwards, it is stunning. You don't have, yeah, one second. And I agree with you that the socialist states actually have done the best, whether it's Cuba or Vietnam or the Soviet Union. But are we willing to give so much political power to the state? Because basically, socialist states were all, in effect, authoritarian states. Totalitarian states, in fact, I would say, in many ways. And when you're referring to the West, that's not true. The early education was actually private, primary education. It was controlled by the church in most of these countries, whether it was in Scandinavia or it was in Northern Europe, even in the United States. And it was not in government hands. It came into government hands quite late. In the late 19th century, and some only in the 20th century, it came into the hands of the state. And they had achieved fairly high rates of literacy, even by this time, and very high rates of industrial growth and economic growth, actually. So it's not necessary that the state should be the sole provider of education. And India is a good example of that. Yeah. Yeah.
Six 6% of the GDP, which every political party puts in its manifesto, the BJP or the UPA 1 and 2 made these promises, and we've never come even close to achieving that. So I would say India is a good example of how public underinvestment in education leads to the outcomes that you're talking about in the ASER reports. But you know, I don't see any evidence that strong public investment in education has ever led to bad outcomes. You're right that public underinvestment in education, which is what we've seen in India. So I think to say that India is a socialist country or whatever, this is, there's been so much public investment which has not led to outcomes. I think that's a fallacy, because the fact is we've just not had enough public investment in education. And that's something we should recognize. And that's true of the state universities as well, that there hasn't been enough public investment. And so I would draw the opposite conclusion. These educational outcomes tell us we need more public investment, not less.
What would really help is to see the growth rate of public investment in education, public expenditure in education, and outcomes, and do a correlation of that and see whether that works out profitably or not. So whether you're getting the best bang for the buck or not. But I agree with you that actually education investment has been very low. But educational investment is a function of electoral priorities. Political priorities. And when the voter is not prioritizing education in his elections, in his voting, in his or her voting, why will the politician put money? It is like the same question which was often asked. So many Dalit parties came up, politicians came up. So many, lower caste politicians came up, so-called lower caste, Adivasi. And yet they did not do anything much for the upliftment of their own brethren. It was because they found that actually it didn't matter for their electoral performance whether they delivered or did not deliver. That is why they didn't deliver. When you are in a system which is based on electoral politics, ballot box politics, incentives matter. Politicians respond to incentives. They will respond if the voter wants that, if the voter can enforce that. But there is other evidence also, social science evidence, which says that even in the US, voters don't have much influence on politicians, actually, in terms of, so maybe there is something wrong itself with this process of first past the post ballot box politics, because if even in the US, social science research is showing that voters are not able to influence political priorities, then what hope do we have here, So I think you're absolutely right that the we have pitifully, but why have we done it? Why do we have money for a Rafael jet, but not for a good public school? One example that we can see which has challenged this paradigm is in Delhi. It's a very important experiment to be studied, actually. Why AAP has been able to improve the quality of Delhi schools? Maybe the results are overinflated and everything, I give you everything. And yet nobody can deny, having gone to those schools 5 years ago and today, that there has been no change. Why has AAP been able to prioritize? Now the question to see is whether AAP will be, this is the critical question, 1 year from now, what the election show, Delhi's coming up for elections in the next 6 months to 1 year. It's a critical election because if AAP loses, That means this is not a priority, sadly.
I listened to this exchange with a lot of interest. I'm just going to share something about what's happening in Myanmar, maybe because I think many of you may not be completely aware of it. Number one, every single university is government controlled. There are no private universities at all. That's the one thing. School education is entirely government controlled. Till 2012, if there is a private party providing education in schools, they were not allowed to be called as schools. So people found out some creative methods. That is, call them academy. You know, find out synonyms, basically. That's the whole thing. So today, even today, 2019, entire education is completely government controlled. So that is the nature of that country. I am not trying to now say anything about what's the outcome. These are all difficult things. But having been in India, working in India, and the last 4 years only I've been in Myanmar, I can only say something. State-based education, state-controlled education and private education, it has its own pros and cons. But in India, what I observe is there are pockets of excellence. There may be widespread mediocrity, but there are pockets of excellence. And these pockets of excellence have not completely come from private education. There are pockets of excellence even with public-sponsored educational institutions. I suspect that it has something to do with what is the extent of control of the government over the education. If the institution has a semblance of autonomy, educational autonomy, and a semblance of fiscal autonomy. See, really what happens is that the government actually can control a lot if you're financially dependent. Even if you have educational autonomy, if you are not independent financially, you have a lot of constraints. And it also has something to do with the size of the educational institution. The engineering institutions in India, if you were to take it, are largely not performing very well private, because you take the engineering institutions in Karnataka, the VTU, it's government controlled, and the system of affiliation has created a monstrously big body which is not easy to govern. But look at, in Karnataka, if you were to consider engineering institutions, which are pockets of excellence, they're smaller in size. So I suspect that it has something to do with the extent of control that the government wields. The financial autonomy that the institution has to do things that they want. And three, it has, I think, something to do with the size. I've not really seen, either in the private sector or in the public controlled education, largely wonderful universities which have a huge size. That's just my thought and observation. And I'm focused on that primarily because in Myanmar, there is no private education. And I tell you what is wrong with that. Because the government just simply does not have the money to grow it to a state where it can really transform people and enrich their lives. There's just simply not enough money. And private funds are necessary. But they don't have the systems at all to invite that foreign direct investment. And that's a big whammy.
I think you're absolutely right. I think the same problem in India, actually, that there is a paucity of government financing.
I just wanted to have your clarification about this. If I'm not wrong, you might have mentioned that South Asian education system is not compatible with manufacturing-led economic growth.
I said the emphasis on higher education, yes, to the detriment of primary and secondary education is not compatible, yes, with manufacturing growth. focusing too much on higher education, spending too much, and not having a literate base that is not spending on primary education, not achieving universal literacy, for example, is not compatible with a manufacturing base.
Or is it like that we are not emphasizing enough on technical education?
That is true. That is also very important. Our vocational and technical education actually expenditure and emphasis is very poor. So that's why, in fact, if you look at China, I'll give you an example. ITI equivalent lines, 100,000 China has. India has just 2,000 ITI equivalent lines. You know, ITI is the one which does vocational things in India, like you learn to become a plumber, electrician. China has tens of thousands of those schools which teach. So when they ask people, why do you go to China? They asked Apple. They asked Microsoft, they asked many of these manufacturers, not Microsoft directly, Apple and these other manufacturers, they asked, why do you go to China? Is it because China is cheaper? They said, no. It's very interesting. We go to China because they have manufacturing skills. We go to China for their skills, actually. At that cost, we can't find that skill anywhere. Otherwise, you know, cost, you can go to Vietnam, it's even cheaper. You can come to India, it's even cheaper. Of course, in India, there's a different problem because of the labor laws and the infrastructure problems. The final cost of the product is very high in India. India is not a low-cost manufacturing destination at all, because when you include all the costs, including the off-the-table costs, India is actually a very high-cost manufacturing economy. We can't compete, therefore, with Vietnam, for example. Bangladesh had this advantage. Bangladesh is a low-cost manufacturing economy.
In case of especially garments, when we compare with India, we have some advantages. Then another thing I would like to share, like our Sri Lankan representative. In Bangladesh also, though, private universities started from 1992. Still, private universities are not permitted by the government to offer research degrees like MPhil or PhD. And in case of public universities, though they are totally dependent on government funding, but they are independent for having their own decisions in every aspect. And there is no accountability in our public university system. And in case of public universities, they don't even count the experience of private universities. If any private university teacher wants to join public university, okay, you come. But your experience is not going to be counted. This is one thing. Or sometimes, yes, we can count. You might have worked for 20 years in private university. We may count for maximum 2 years experience could be added. And another thing is that UGC, that is the supreme body for looking after higher education, that UGC is composed of teachers from public universities. So they take every decision in favor of public universities. So these are some other issues we might share in coming days. Thank you.
I want to just comment on these last two things that you said. This is very important. The same problem in India. The UGC is composed only of people from public universities. Therefore, even research funding is not available. Unlike in the US, in the US, private universities can bid for government. In fact, a large amount of the budget of Johns Hopkins, of Harvard, etc., comes from competitively bidding for government funds from the National Science Foundation. In India, you can't. We have tried many times. We don't get any funding as private universities. They refuse.
UGC. So, how this term goes? Okay.
But
so all grants are taken away by the public universities. I think these are the issues.
But there's a more fundamental problem that you have just pointed towards, actually.
Just as a counter
so,
to that.
So the representation of private universities might be needed, or teachers from private universities may be needed in UGCs or governing bodies or regulatory bodies. That might be some points we may consider in our book.
In India, we have done better. We do not have private representatives, but a non-existent private institute has become got the tag of eminence. You don't really need representatives to achieve something like that. So anyway, that was not the point. I wanted to make a quick rejoinder. I thought your whole presented a pretty gloomy picture of South Asia. And I find the entire framing of that rather problematic, and I'm not sure where to begin. So I'll just like mention a couple of things. One about modernity being the bane of South Asia.
I didn't say it's a bane, I said it's a double-edged thing.
I am saying it's a bane, but that's what we are getting from what you said. It's a double-edged thing. Yes, you did say it is a double-edged intervention. But that's a historical inevitability. I suppose we had moments when we could have probably chalked out our own path of modernity, but here we are with this. And I think there's a lot of literature that looks at modernity and talks about how South Asian modernity is quite distinct from Western modernity and the implications that that has had for education systems among other institutions that we have in our country. So even the role of the state, for instance, you spoke of how in South Asia religion plays such an important role. But isn't it interesting, and correct me if I'm wrong, that in all the South Asian countries, we have modern education system. Way of life privileges religion, but the education system itself is modern. And I don't think anywhere it's religious education system, it's largely secular modern. So there are these paradoxes that we have, which probably need much closer attention to than saying this or that. And also in terms of the state intervention itself, the kind of importance you're giving to the state, I don't know if we have such strong states. I think one of the issues with South Asia is that the states are pretty weak. They are strong in their nationalist content. They are nation states, so there is this national histories that are pretty strongly put forward, and that is what comes into the education system in the most predominant manner. But otherwise, I think the states are pretty weak, and there is an analysis of why we have these weak South Asian states. And how that then impacts education is something that we would need to look at. So in some areas of education, yes, the state does interfere, does control. But I'm not sure if you would have had the kind of spread in education if we didn't have state intervention, if it wasn't public in the first place, right?
Sorry?
If it wasn't publicly funded, if it wasn't for the state involvement with education, you wouldn't have had the kind of spread of education that we've had in all the South Asian countries. So to say, I mean, to come to a point where you say that the state is a problem, yes, it may be a problem, but I think we would probably have to nuance in what ways it's a problem, and that whether the private sector is the answer to that, I'm not so sure. Because again, to go back to your example of Ashoka University and its output in the last few years, I don't know if that again is a good indicator. I mean, research is increasingly being made as the only indicator of quality education. But we also, I mean, the main point about higher education or education, as Neeta pointed out, is the children, the students there.
Mm.
What kind of teaching, who's getting the education?
Mm.
I think you need to ask a number of questions before you can arrive at a decision or an assessment of which is better. And anyway, I'm not sure if that is the most important. I mean, privatization in South Asian countries is an important part, but to rate one as better than the other on these grounds, I'm not so sure I would agree with it. So these are just some of the points that I want to
make. I just want to respond quickly. Because I'll forget it. So just one comment I have. I did not claim that private education was better than public education, but I am saying that they both have their place. But this criticism, especially in India, of private education as catering only to one segment of the population, I think this needs to be nuanced, you know. And sure, public education does provide a much wider sociological social context. True, but also we have to see what quality of education we are delivering. We are delivering to those social strata. That's very important, I think. And the second thing is, I agree totally with you that the weak state, actually, I was going to put that in the talk, but I forgot, is actually something very common to all of South Asia. You're absolutely right. The state is a weak state, and we know this because if you look at the tax to GDP ratios for all of these states, that reveals it. And that could be a problem. The problem may not, you're right, may not be in education. It might be in the fact that the state itself is weak, which is having an impact on education.
Thank you very much. Fascinating discussion about public and private education. I just want to share the example from Maldives. Maldives has a very high literacy rate since 1990. Our literacy rate is 98%.
Wow.
But this percentage was not achieved by government effort. When there was a major intervention to raise literacy, Maldives had a 72% literacy rate. This was achieved largely by the communities themselves.
Mm.
Maldives has a very, it's the smallest population in the South Asian context, but it is widely distributed. The small population is distributed in 200 plus islands. But these communities fended themselves and they educate, they achieve this literacy through their own community efforts. When the state intervened, it had already reached 70%. But of course, the state intervention was able to take it up to 98%. And even primary education, the communities offered through themselves. But there is only a certain point that the communities can take. It was only in late 1970s, when the state intervened, that they were able to take it to a further level, higher level. So this role of the state has become very important in terms of achieving it at a higher level and also bringing up to quality. And lately, in the last 10 years, all the community schools were nationalized. They became government schools. But later on, in the recent government, they are trying to provide some private initiatives. They are offering some state schools to be owned and operated by private, but this is in a limited scale. But by that time, I mean, the state's intervention has actually upgraded the system, improved the quality in teachers and things like that. So I just wanted to share that into the discussion.
I'm just a little concerned about the unproblematic historical narrative of a learning culture in South Asia. I'm not familiar with other South Asian countries, but at least in India, it was a very deeply hierarchical society. And the story that you shared is more of an outlier than the mainstay.
I agree. You're absolutely right. I used it only as indicative of the political changes and sociological changes that have happened in the last 200 years. Anybody else?
I had a couple of brief comments. One was just to add to your, I think, fairly nuanced presentation of history. I think a concept which would be useful to also add to that kind of a narrative and which relates to this discussion which we are having about the actual weakness or strength of the state vis-a-vis schools and universities would be that of hegemony versus authoritarianism. You know, something that, say, the historian Ranajit Guha has written about. And he points out very very nicely, very carefully, I think. And this would also make us draw a relationship between the colonial period and today. Because otherwise it's difficult to explain what you're saying, which is how modernity was introduced in the colonial period. And yet it didn't, quote-unquote, succeed. And yet it's the result of that we are suffering from. So did it succeed? Did it fail? What was the nature? And here you can see that when something which could potentially be good is introduced, but it's not the people's desire that it be introduced, then this someone else's desire doesn't work for you, even though you secretly have that same desire. But then the tendency is to subvert that. So the results or the outcome is then very already problematized. It's sabotaged just by yourself. So that's one very important thing. And I think the other concept that I'd love to have us talk about and think about would be the role of this intellectual or intelligentsia or the educated class, because they're also not just educated. They're all people rooted in socioeconomic positions. And therefore, it's just not the legislators that you mentioned or the teachers or anyone else. Every single person is also going to work according to their socioeconomic positions. And there's a very poor result of the role played by educated middle classes and upwardly mobile middle classes in India compared to some of the European or developed countries. Mm. They just haven't taken on the mantle that of leadership that their position should have led them to. And we should talk about that, not just about state and entrepreneurs.
I think that is critical, actually. What you're saying is so critical. And it actually comes out both from Sri Lanka and from the experience of Maldives. I wanted to say that this dichotomy between public and private, and let's not make this an ideological distinction. Let's look at the evidence. And the evidence shows that even in India, where literacy was achieved, you know, Kerala, for example, Travancore State, and Kerala later, there was a large civil society push. Young people sacrificed several years of their life. I know a couple of people now old who spent 2 years in a village. Educated people in Kerala, they left, they went and spent 2 years in a village and taught in that village, you know, to every child there. It was with a huge push. So it may not have been, I'm not saying it's the private sector, but I'm saying it's not also the state alone which can achieve that. It was a, otherwise if it was the state alone, then Kerala's result should have been achieved by everybody. Maldives' result should have been achieved by everybody. Sri Lanka's result should have been achieved by, it is a combination. And this comes from a part-dependent project. Those societies, it's not that Kerala people were so special, you know, or Europeans are so special and white people are so special. There is a part dependency of the geography, of the social structure, of the history, of the economics of that place, of the institutions of that place, which pushes that, you know, and brings it out. And I totally agree with you. I should have brought out the nuances, but I didn't have the time and I couldn't bring it out, that actually it was a deeply hierarchical structure. In fact, Dauji himself would not have received an education at all, actually, in the normal course of things. It was a miracle that he received. And that's why in this story, he keeps referring to the miracle that his master did by taking him. Because otherwise, he would have just been a shepherd all his life, which is the title of the story, the Gadariya. And it is a privileged position, totally. The boy also is admitting it, that I was privileged. My father was a lawyer. That's why I could get this education. And I could go to England. I could go to Lahore and all that. And you're absolutely right. It's problematic in many ways because there is corporal punishment. We know, not in this story, but we know in that time, I mean, the most famous instrument of teaching was Maula Baksh. Maula Baksh was a big cane that every teacher used to carry into class. You know, so there was corporal punishment involved with small children. So there's a lot of, and we know the effects of that. We are having the effects of that. It's again part dependent. The fact that education was restricted to 1% of the population, and only males at that, not even females, mostly. We can see the struggle. The reason we have such a high emphasis on higher education was precisely because of that, actually. The society demand was for higher education because the upper classes of society were the ones who were able to implement that demand. The lower classes were not able to implement. That's why we ended up with today a service economy. People are hailing India. People used to hail India. You know, the media used to hail in the 90s and 2000s. We have become an IT superpower. You have become an IT superpower because you were a Brahminical state from the beginning, you know. That's why you became an IT superpower. Otherwise, you would have been a manufacturing superpower. The base would have been moved up. The base was never moved up. Mass jobs can only be created through manufacturing.
So it is related to your story. That is about, like, he asked to read Kalmas, right? You just mentioned that.
Which Kalma?
Yeah, which Kalma, right? So I want to know that there are many kinds of history, like people's history, then you have state history, then history portrayed by media, history portrayed by textbooks. So which history to be considered to be true? And the second is, you also mentioned about there is a diverging line between the literacy in the North India and the South India. So, which are those factors which made this diverging line? So, these are the two things.
Yeah. That's a very hard question to answer. Because there are many factors which led to that. The history question also is a very complex question, but there's an essay by E.H. Carr, you know, you should look at it, What is History? And it's not, you're absolutely right that there's so many versions of the past, you know, which version is correct. And what he seems to be indicating is that what you arrive at is a consensus of academics. What we consider history at any point is the consensus, not history as in academic history I'm talking about, not state or public, is the consensus of academics who look at the past. So at one point, we had a very different view of history and historiography. Then it was changed over the 19th century. You know, India's own history is largely a product of our encounter with Europe, actually. It was Europeans who worked on our history first. We didn't know about Ashoka, actually. We didn't know about Indus Valley. They are the ones who looked at it. So then Indian experts also started getting involved. And of course, even when the Europeans looked at it, it was in conjunction with the scholars from India, Brahmins from Benares, Brahmins from Calcutta, and Persian scholars in the declining Mughal court. But, you know, what is history? It has to emerge from the consensus of the community. It's not like, you know, it's not like physics, like you can just do it an experiment in a lab and create and verify this was history, you know. A range of products are used, you know, a range of materials is used, from text to, you know, archaeological evidence to all kinds of stuff. And then consensus is achieved among the academics. And that is at one prevailing. And then it can be overturned or changed or modified as time progresses, you know. I'm just kind of summarizing this article. But why is there a line not only between North and South, but between East and Western India and all that? Again, it's a very part-dependent thing. It depends on the historical, political, sociological conditions, economic conditions which emerged in those areas, and what kind of politics it gave rise to. It's a complex process.
Thank you, Mohsin. I think you agreed to take on a very complex task, and I think you've been able to portray a very complex set of factors, historical, cultural, economic, political, which we agree or disagree, but they nevertheless intersect with how we think about education and its development and its consequences for society. So thank you for opening it all up for us.
Thank you.
And I think we'll come back to your talk in various forms.
Thank you.
Later today, tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you.